This is going to be a meme.
Father, I'm just so grateful for the chance right now to pray for Tekashi 69. Thank you for what's on his life. Thank you, Lord, for the gift and the talent you've given him.
Pop these like a willy. You a silly in the hood with them billy and them hooving. You run up and they shooting. We ain't hooping. No KB, you a losing. I'm that Uzi.
For the love of money.
Thank you, Lord, for the gift and the talent you've given him.
I'm thinking, that's moral. And then within a split second, I'm thinking, that's criminal.
This is the sign of the horns. A curse sign, the two fingers extended. This way, spread apart for sort of shotgun blast.
Let's just say Planned Parenthood decides to write some Christian music that would pass a doctrinal smell test. Would you sing it in your church?
Put them to the test. Those that proclaim to speak or to deliver or word of God, put that to the test. So how do you test it? What's the measure that you use to test the teaching? You take all that they say about Jesus, all that they say about God, all that they say about grace, about redemption, about salvation. You lay that side by side with the Word of God, and it should be abundantly clear.
Carl, I want to get close like that wisp.
October 1999 was the fateful day where I was having a meeting in my office with one of my colleagues, and he went on to tell me that someone had rung into our church office and had made a complaint that 30 years before my father had abused a boy. We didn't cover it up. We did tell people straight away. We did take his credential off him. He never did preach again. And we did oversee and ensure that he was never put in a position to be close to kids to be able to do that again. What we didn't do is report it to the police.
I would submit to you that singing Bethel and Hillsong when you're sending money to those false churches, that's far worse.
Tonight, the truth about the Hillsong Church and how they're taking ordinary Aussie taxpayers for a ride.
People are really starting to ask questions about why they're going to work and paying tax, and, you know, these guys are going to work and not paying any at all.
We'll reveal the tax-free millions this mega church is making, the lavish lifestyles of its founders, Brian and Bobby Houston, and we've got the documents that show where all the money is really going.
Bethel and Hillsong, these are false churches, and they are dens of wolves, and they are out there trying to prey upon your sheep. So guard your sheep. Love them enough to guard them.
And down there, smack bang, right in the middle of it, is Hillsong headquarters, a $25 million monstrosity that looks more like an entertainment center than a church.
Other Hillsongs have sprung up in Melbourne and Brisbane, where police are needed to manage the huge crowds who come every weekend. Inside, it's all about the show. There's rock music, huge video screens, and its charismatic frontman, Brian Houston.
Believe for the favour and grace of God on your life. That's what I believe.
What sort of person is Brian Houston?
He's a very slick creation of his own making, I think. He would have been successful in almost any business, but he found Christianity, and that's been his real bonanza, I think.
I'm gonna show you what you're watching.
Brian Houston.
Brian Houston.
Hold on, we'll get him a chair.
Hi. Now,
let Pastor Brian sit.
Nah, look, Pastor. Here, you have to give to receive, and the more you give, the more God will like you.
Sowing so that we can reap, so that we can sow, that we can reap.
Every Sunday there are 84 services like this held around Australia and the world, each one raking in tens of thousands at a time. Places like New York, London and Paris now have a Hillsong, Brian Houston and his glamorous wife Bobby come from New Zealand. It was 30 years ago this year when they set up the Hills Christian Life Centre. Their first service was in a school hall. Just 45 people showed up. Tanya Levin joined when she was a teenager.
In the early days, there was very little emphasis on money. There were only a few hundred people. There were working class families, most of them. And it wasn't a focus at all.
The Hills Christian Life Centre would become Hillsong, where these days the talk is often about money and membership.
It's learn how to attract people. It's amazing how your finances will grow.
Brian Houston even wrote a book called You Need More Money. There's a constant call for funds to expand his church and his empire.
How generous are you? How generous are you?
They're very explicit about what they want. They want to recruit more people and they want to raise as many funds as possible, because the more people that you have in, the more opportunity to fundraise.
Don't give in the sense of like, well, what I did last year, how about let's have a new way? New way of giving. For instance,
it's Sunday morning and we're undercover at this Hillsong service. Within minutes, the talk turns to money.
Tithe this year. And if you do tithe, how about do it online? It's a new way. It's different. You
know, we're told to give more than we've ever given before, in the form of a tithe.
So how about this year? Do a new way. Give in a new way. Give joyfully. Give online. Give cheerfully. And you find, I tell you what, God will bless you. It's a new year. It's a new year. And let's expect that. All right?
What's the idea behind tithing and where does it come from?
10% of your pre-tax income, whatever that is. It's this idea that if you don't give, you're robbing God. And you don't want to rob God, do you?
What about people who can't afford to give? The unemployed, people on disability pensions, single parents. Are they let off the hook?
No. Everybody has to tithe. They will tell you that it goes back to Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, and that's why Cain killed Abel, because he didn't tithe.
How would you describe the lifestyle of Brian and Bobby Houston?
Oh, it's got to be just short of Jana Reinhart. It's a luxurious lifestyle. It's an international, cosmopolitan, celebrity lifestyle.
Brian rides a Harley and travels the world earning money for his ministry.
When Brian Houston goes to speak at foreign churches, he's given what they call love offerings, which often can be, you know, piles of cash that he carries away in a suitcase.
Not only are Brian and Bobby Houston living luxury lifestyles, they're also working the system to pay as little tax as possible. And here's how they're doing it. They've set up an entity called Leadership Ministries Incorporated, or LMI, and it has tax-free status. The Houstons own two properties and they sold them to LMI, so it doesn't have to pay any tax on them. Brian Houston has previously confirmed that he's paid $150,000 to be a pastor at Hillsong. Any money that he donates from that into LMI is tax-free. And then, of course, there's all that other money that he earns preaching around the world and selling all his books and DVDs. That all goes into LMI, you guessed it, tax-free.
Depending on its balance each year, but at times it's been $1 million tax-free expense account for the Houstons.
Do you think they're entitled to that tax-free lifestyle?
Of course not. It's quite similar to a pyramid scheme where they're making money out of other people's hard work, and the more people they can have under them working for them to promote them, the more they profit, and they profit hugely. And they profit internationally as well.
Welcome to another episode of Redeeming Truth. This one will not be controversial at all. The question is, why do we here at our church and in our convictions not sing or direct people to Bethel music, Jesus culture, Hillsong, Elevation Worship with Stephen Furtick, and all those like-minded movements. While we are grateful for the zeal and the passion of some of these ministries, the well-intentioned, seemingly well-intentioned drive to reach people and to reach a culture and to reach a generation, you know, you guys can speak to this. Passion, while it's essential, we want to be passionate. Goodness, you got to be passionate about the truth and about something in life, or you'll just kind of live this mundane existence. Passion can be essential, but it's not always reliable. Speak to that for a quick minute as we start here.
Yeah, I mean, what's the most important thing about the gospel? That we get it right, right? Truth is the most important thing. If we're worshiping the wrong Jesus, we're outside of the grace of God. So we have to be focused on truth. And if we're passionate, we have to be passionate about the truth. And I would take anyone who asks this question to Ephesians 5. In Ephesians 5, verse 15 and following, it gives us a way to live life. It says, look carefully how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of your time. And go down to a few verses later, it says, be filled with the Spirit, addressing one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, making melody to the Lord with your heart. So Christians are commanded to sing. Not only that, we're commanded to address each other and in fact teach each other through music. So if our music is being used as a vehicle to teach false doctrine or even doctrine that looks true but is not quite there, then we should reject it wholeheartedly, because if we're filled with the Spirit singing songs, we will be filled with songs that sing truth.
Okay, so clearly we've played our cards. The position would be that these movements are false, teaching false doctrines, that music matters, mm-hmm. lyrics matter. So let me quickly quote things and make sure that we're being fair and mm-hmm. accurate. Mm-hmm. And then Dale, I want you to chime in certainly based on this. So what Bethel teaches, and Bill Johnson being one of the heads of this movement and what is typically coined now the New Apostolic Reformation, mm-hmm. What Todd White teaches and believes, what is spread throughout these areas, conferences and places like the Send and others, they are teaching, based on Philippians 2, 5 through 7, that Jesus was just a man in right relationship to God. He was not God when he did his miracles, his signs, his wonders. He was just a man living like we could now today. Mm-hmm. And so, based on that, we can do them too. And we're supposed to be living this supernatural lifestyle that not supernatural as in leading people to Christ, the miracle of salvation, or even just praying for people and seeing God move in remarkable ways. But actually, supernatural meaning we're prophets, we're apostles, we are healers, we're miracle workers, and going around and doing the like. And so you know we're being fair. I want to quote Bill Johnson from page 29 of his book, When Heaven Invades Earth, where he says, Jesus did his miracles, his signs, wonders, as a man in right relationship to God. And then there's an ellipsis. Not as God. Later on in the book, When Heaven Invades Earth, on page 79, he says these exact words, he laid his divinity aside. Mm. That is Christological heresy. To use the H word in the realist literal sense, that is Christological heresy. You cannot, based on not only the teaching of Scripture, but the Council of Chalcedon, the early church, all the way through the ages, even to now, say that Jesus just at any point, you know, wasn't God. Mm-hmm. He laid aside his divinity. They base it on Philippians 2. Mm-hmm. They say that the kenosis, or the emptying of Christ, was an emptying of his divinity, his divine nature, mm-hmm. and that he laid that aside as a model to just show us how we could do it too.
What you're going to see first is a video clip of their pastor, Bill Johnson, describing how in some of their meetings they've now been having glory clouds show up. They've been having physical encounters with God. Have we heard them talk about how they desire for kids to do that? Having a physical encounter with God through, well, a glory cloud, where God shows up in a glory cloud. Here's Bill Johnson explaining this glory cloud that keeps showing up, and then you're going to see footage of this glory cloud in just a minute. Here's Bill Johnson.
And at the end, they had a fire tunnel and started ministering to people, and this glory cloud just came and just started hovering somewhere over the platform. I'm not sure where that one was, but there's this cloud. It's hard to explain. It looks like smoke, looks like dust, and when you get close, it's like gold. It's shiny. It's like little flakes, teeny weeny little flakes, and they're just swirling. The next week, the 19th of August, was a women's conference, and the same thing happened again. I know that night it was over in that corner. And then this last Friday night, this cloud appeared again. And this time, it remained there for approximately 45 minutes. It would intensify, it would get thick, it would there was at one time there was like this smoke billowing and it exploded. It was like a ball. It exploded and just shot up all of the gold. I'm going to show you a little clip and it looked like smoke to you. You'll see some little sparkles, but it's like gold flakes and they all went up.
A glory cloud, gold flakes. Encountering Jesus, encountering God, the supernatural. All right, so let me show you footage of this glory cloud that reportedly showed up at Bill Johnson's church. Folks, I don't know what's going on there. That's either manufactured or possibly demonic.
There is a large church in Miami named El Rey Jesus, King Jesus Church, pastored by a guy named Guillermo Maldonado. Now, Guillermo Maldonado is the Bill Johnson of Miami.
Okay.
And he and Bill Johnson are good friends. Mm. Long story short, there was a lady who came to the conference I was teaching. She came up to me, she introduced herself. She said, I used to be in El Rey Jesus. And I said, oh, really? No, she said, oh, yeah. She said, I was high up in it. She said, my husband is still in it. Maybe it's too much. Hold on, hope I don't get in trouble. But her husband is still in it. She got saved, genuinely saved, converted, left it, as you would expect a Christian to do, left the church. And I was talking about some of the manifestations in Maldonado's church, Bill Johnson. Well, anyway, she came up to me. She said, Justin, you know how Maldonado's church has the gold dust? I said, yeah. She said, that was my job. She said, I was tasked, her and a friend of hers, we were told to go upstairs with canisters of, you can't make this stuff up, with canisters of real fine gold glitter of sorts.
And Hobby she said, Lobby glitter.
Yeah. And she said, it was our job to dump it into the ventilation system. And of course, it blew out over the whole congregation. And people thought that that was
the presence of God.
You can't exegete an experience. And Tom, one of the things I teach people, and this is something I really want to drive home, I don't deny that people are having some kind of an experience. What I question is the source of those experiences.
It gives them a buzz.
Oh, absolutely. It absolutely gives them a buzz.
So it's a chemical thing.
Yeah, it's what the whole thing is predicated on. It does give them a buzz. They do feel something.
Right.
That's why there's so much music, and it goes on. I've been to Benny Hinn Crusades. The music goes on for 2 to 3 hours before Benny Hinn ever comes on the platform.
Right. Yeah.
And you've heard that Costi Hinn, Benny Hinn's nephew, was genuinely converted about 5-6 years ago, and now he's theologically where you and I are. And cessationist.
Perfect.
I tell people,
perfect in every way.
Yes,
that's where you and I are.
Right.
If everybody would just listen.
We've got it all figured out.
Yeah.
And I tell people, you know, if your last name is Hinn and you're a cessationist, you've come a long way.
Yes. And if you are a member of the Hinn family, you live lavishly. You travel the world in style, unless you question Pastor Hinn's theology, as his nephew Costi Hinn did. I sat down with Costi and found he paid a price. You said growing up in the Hinn family dynasty is a hybrid of a royal family and the mafia.
Yeah.
What does that mean?
The lavishness of the royal family and then the strict enforcement of a mafia type of family. I mean, you keep to your own, you defend your own. You never, ever, regardless of what the truth might be, do anything to harm or expose or, you know, at the expense of family. It's just a tight-lipped, tight-knit community. You know, the first time I ever said anything publicly, as a pastor, which I was obligated to, people were asking, and I can't lie. And, you know, I did say something, and I got a phone call from a family member, and they said, you need to pipe down. Don't talk about family.
You talked about the lavish lifestyle.
Yeah.
That's intriguing to many people. Tell me what that was like.
Living the dream, honestly. You fly on a G4, a G5. You're climbing the ladder of Gulfstream airliners. Every time he gets a new one, it's really fun. And I worked with him, so we traveled that way. And you would just go on layovers to Monte Carlo. You'd stay at the Hotel de Paris, and you'd kind of wander and see Ferraris and Bentleys everywhere. And then the Burj Al Arab in Dubai, and you get picked up. Back then, it was 3 white Bentleys. I think they use Rolls Royces now. And you'd walk into the royal suite and there's brushed gold everywhere and the suites are $25,000 a night. You would just be everywhere all over the world.
But you're also preaching about Jesus, who was a poor man, and justifying this lavish lifestyle. How? With theology?
Well, with some twisted theology. And if you take the Bible and you take what Jesus taught and you take some of the promises of heaven and the riches of heaven and the wonderful glories of heaven and you make them a now thing, then you really have a model for your best life now. And that's really not the heartbeat of Christianity. The heartbeat of Christianity is, if you have wealth, you want to be generous and rich in good works. And if God has blessed you with a lot, you have a great responsibility. On the flip side, if you're poor, God still loves you. He still has a purpose and plan for you. And in your poverty, he's still with you. And the hope of heaven is much greater than the riches of now and the temporary pleasures. So you twist that and you get the prosperity gospel.
Is prosperity preaching, if I do these certain things, that I'll become wealthy because that's what God wants?
Ultimately, that's the heart of prosperity preaching. And Jesus...
Now, people from other religions would say, would be confused by that.
Absolutely. And they are. They very much are. And poor people in third world countries that are doing all the steps that prosperity preachers say to do, they're giving the last of their money, they're showing up, they're kind of hailing the holy man in all his glory, hoping that they'll receive blessings. They're not. You put a guy on the platform in a real nice suit in a very beautiful auditorium, and he'll tell a whole bunch of Americans, if you do this, do this, and do this, you'll get this. And God is like your magic genie. If you rub him right and you do all the right things, your bank's going to grow, you're going to get that promotion, you're going to get that woman that you want to marry or that perfect man, and your life is going to be perfect because that's what God wants for you.
What if it turns out your life isn't perfect, though? What have you done wrong?
That's the big question, isn't it? That's why people get hurt. And real pastors and real churches have to stand up and say, no, that is not Christianity. That's not what the Bible teaches.
What did you think of your old self?
I was disgusted. I really was. And the gospel then became real. And I mean the real gospel, Bible teaching, which is not just the good news. It's the bad news, too. It's the other side that maybe some preachers don't really ever mention. They say, well, I want to stay in my lane. My job is to preach hope. And our job as preachers and pastors is to give the whole story. It's bad news. I was greedy. I was very ambitious for all the wrong things. We were teaching things that were wrong, taking advantage, exploiting the poor, using our greed, squeezing every last dollar out of people so we could live the way they could never. Using Jesus to do that, I was disgusted. And then I quickly realized the gospel is also good news. Jesus died to forgive my sins. He loves me just the way I am and all my mess and all my greed. And if I commit to a change, he'll meet me right where I am. And he did. And he changed my heart. And I just had no taste for it anymore. I did not want that life.
So that brings us to today, though, because you have rejected prosperity preaching, the type of preaching your uncle does. So do you still have a relationship with him?
No, it's really limited. He's pretty upset with me.
The Bible says the wealth of the
sinner. Do you hope that your uncle will one day visit your church?
I'd love him to, but I would rather him just call me. Just say, Costi, let's talk. Be honest about some of the things that he's done and taught and said, and just get really honest. And maybe he's 63, maybe in this last 10-year run here of when he's got his strength, do it right and show the world what the grace of God really is. And show the world what hope is and what change is and lasting change. And if God can change me, God could change you. God can change anybody. And it's not really about all the other stuff.
I want to show you what Jesus had to say when it came to the subject of judging others. Turn with me in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 7. Because this is where the quote comes from. Judge not lest you be judged. Matthew chapter 7. If you're there, say I'm there. Some of you just said, I'm there, and you're turning your pages, so I'm on to you. I got it. Matthew chapter 7, verse number 1 says, do not judge others, and you will not be judged. Verse 2, for you will be treated as you treat others. The standard you use in judging is the standard by which you will be judged. And why worry about a speck in your friend's eye when you have a log in your own? How can you think of saying to your friend, let me help you get rid of the speck in your eye, when you can't see past the log in your own eye? Hypocrites. First, get rid of the log in your own eye. Then you will see well enough to deal with the speck in your friend's eye. Jesus does give us a warning about judging others. But the judging he's warning us about is the hypocritical kind of judging. He says, look, you want to deal with the speck that's in your brother's eye, but you've got a plank in your own. You can't help that brother. Deal with yourself first. And then when you're in a right place, in a right position, then you can help your brother and sister deal with the speck that's in their eye. He's not saying don't judge. He says just don't be a hypocrite. So we often quote verse number 1, judge not lest ye be judged. But we don't even make it to verse number 6. Look at verse 6. I'm reading out the New Living Translation. It says, don't waste what is holy on people who are unholy. Or another translation, don't give the sacred to dogs. Jesus says, don't give the sacred things to dogs. And then he says, don't throw your pearls to pigs. They will trample the pearls, then turn and attack you. Do you just catch what Jesus did? He identified some people as dogs and some people as pigs. And so in order to obey verse number 6, then we have to make some judgmental decisions about other people's character and conduct. You have to be able to know, look, don't waste what is holy on those that are outright rebellious and unholy. Be able to discern between, you know, is that person a dog or is that person a pig, using the language of our Lord in the context of what he was saying.
From Pastor Brian Houston, money. There's not one person in this building who doesn't need more money. And if you say, well, I don't need more money, then I would say you have a very poor outlook on life.
You'll learn why you need more money.
Because money is a tool that can accomplish phenomenal things. What money can do in your head is bless, it can help, it can build, it can increase, it can bring vision, it can strengthen.
You'll learn how to get more money. And you'll learn how to have wealth without having a love for money.
Poor does not have to be permanent. All the answers here, you say, well, you know, how do you know that? Because why would the scripture say, let the poor say, I am rich? If it wasn't the will of God to break the power of poverty over people's lives.
In this life-changing tape series, Pastor Brian Houston will challenge you to live according to the principles of God and see his blessing on your life.
God is like your magic genie.
Money!
Michael, what was it for you? I mean, what were some of the red flags that you began to see that got the dam open, if you will?
Yeah, as I'm listening to Costi speak here, I'm grateful for you guys having me on today. I think, why would I come on talking about my family in a negative sense?
Yeah.
And mm-hmm. I think about how I came out of the prosperity gospel, and I hope that God will use these kind of programs to bring others out of the prosperity gospel as well. For me, so I went to Oral Roberts University, very charismatic college. I then went to work for Mike Murdoch, who's a prosperity gospel teacher in Texas. So I bought in from day one. I wanted to be an entrepreneur, a businessman, and I wanted to, you know, reap the harvest of all the seeds I was sowing into
these
different ministries.
And you've grown up with Kenneth Copeland and all.
Yeah, so from a young age, I was going to conferences with Costi's uncle, Kenneth Copeland, Paula White.
This is one of the greatest men. And before we start out, we'd like to pray over him.
Joyce Meyer, Miles Monroe. I went to college with Miles Monroe's son. And so I was around it all the time, conferences throughout the year, and was going to a prosperity gospel church here in San Diego. And the crack for me was that one friend in particular was telling me that it was heretical and to look into these things. And another thing for me was I didn't see the difference in the teaching I was hearing at church and Tony Robbins.
When a woman asks, do you need to stop for a drink, you need to pee, women don't really mean what they say.
And so for me, I felt like I was just hearing motivational teaching with no gospel. And I knew the gospel enough to know that this wasn't the true gospel. And so each week I was going to the
It wasn't even being mangled, it just wasn't there.
Right, and when it was there, it was so soft that I didn't know I was a sinner in need of my sins being saved. And words like repentance, holiness, righteousness, those just words that weren't used because they were there to encourage me, make me feel better about myself. And I wasn't being presented the true gospel. So a friend of mine was, a reformed friend, was just sending me YouTube videos on preaching of really solid guys. And I started watching those. And then I was still going to my prosperity gospel church and seeing, like, these two are not the same. Like, one of these is focused on Christ and one of these is focused on me, the individual. And so eventually over time, it was a slow process, probably about a year and a half or so, that I started to realize that I was not in a biblically faithful church, and that even my own family was not preaching the gospel. Mm-hmm. And then that's where it kind of leads into analyzing the conferences, which is the gospel is just not there. It's all about health, wealth, anointing is a very big thing, mm-hmm. faith being a force. There's so many different subject matters in the prosperity gospel, even outside of finances, that are just so misapplied and misunderstood.
I am victorious. I am blessed. I am talented. I am anointed. I am amazing. I am wonderful. I am valuable. I am a masterpiece. I am young. I am energetic. I am vibrant. I am radiant. I am fresh. I am blessed. I am strong. I am talented. I am disciplined. I am focused. I am prosperous. I am being renewed in my youth. I am full of health, vitality, wholeness. I am beautiful. I am a masterpiece. I am one of a kind. I am hand-picked by Almighty God. I am valuable. I am a masterpiece. I am royalty. I am crowned with favor. I am smart. I am full of wisdom. I am blessed. I am successful. I am surrounded by God's favor. I am equipped. I am empowered. I am anointed. I am strong. I am confident. I am equipped. I am blessed. I am prosperous. I am free. I am talented. I am improving. I am getting better and better. I am equipped. I am confident. I am more than a conqueror. I am approved by Almighty God.
No, when you're poor, broke, and defeated, all that proves is that you're poor, broke, and defeated. It doesn't bring any honor to God. If I brought my two children up on the platform today, and their clothes were all raggedy, worn out, holes in their shoes, hair not combed, you would look at me and think, what kind of father is he?
Bring no more vain offerings, saith the Lord. I delight not in the blood of bullocks and of lambs. The sacrifice God demands is a repentant heart.
It'd be a poor reflection on me. Listen, when you look good, dress good, live in a nice place, excel in your career, generous with others, that brings a smile to God's face. It brings him pleasure to prosper you.
I leaned over and told Pastor Randy that I love for Donnie to sing hymns. He went into a little bit of standing on the promises. I love to hear him sing hymns. I think hymns are something that we need back in the church. We need them. We need them back in the church. I like all the new stuff. It's wonderful. But never get rid of the hymns. The word hymn comes from the same word that we get hymen. It is meant to break the seal that causes you to go into the womb of worship. And when a hymn is released properly, you go into a womb of worship where births and healings and miracles and deliverance comes. It breaks through the wall of the flesh and it takes you into the inner sanctum of God's glory and presence.
The other thing I'm excited about tonight and really, really, really glad to have is this tremendous woman of God who I feel silly trying to introduce her because everybody in the world knows her. If you don't know who this woman is, you don't have a TV. You don't have a cell phone. You don't have a computer. You haven't been anywhere. She is a pastor extraordinaire. Yes. She is a life coach. She is an author in her own rights. Yes. She is a woman of integrity that God is using in a very, very unique way, not only in Church Without Walls there in Tampa, Florida, but throughout America and around the world. Would you welcome Dr. Paula White? We are glad to have you. Yay. We love you. We are
you.
It's my honor.
I know you've been ripping and running and going everywhere, but tell us what's going on with you right now.
Well, first I want to say what an honor it is to be with the two of you. In life, I believe that Henry Drummond said that we are all mosaics of the men in our life, the people in our lives, and that we become a part of those that we interact with. A large part of who I am, the development, the cultivation, the staying on a track, the maturing is due to the two people that I have the privilege to sit with, that I have been able to call my spiritual father and mother for almost 23 years. I adore, admire, love him.
The Lord sent me here to feed somebody this morning. Hallelujah. I've been hand selected. I've been divinely picked. I've been Holy Ghost anointed. I've been designated for the assignment. God, I will not fail you.
I think that Jesus is the product.
If Jesus is the product, then Bishop T.D. Jakes is one of the Lord's top sales.
They've known each other for years, but it was a chance conversation that brought these preaching powerhouses together. Jakes thought Lakewood would be a good place to host his annual men's conference, so he came to take a look.
He loved seeing the auditorium. We spent about an hour here just walking around. I had him play with the lights on the ceiling.
These Texas titans of televangelism have a lot in common. Both are well known, both are wealthy. Osteen has written 3 best-selling books. Jakes has written more than 30, along with producing music, plays, and movies.
One of the things I asked him about is what you both get criticized for, and that's being, you know, ministers of prosperity. Did you ever talk about that and some of the slings and arrows that are directed at you?
We did, and it's funny, some of the things he said stuck with me, and I said, what would you do different, just because he's been doing it longer? He said, I would realize who I should ignore quicker.
I said, what God has for you is for you.
Meaning that you're going to get criticized for something. You might as well get criticized for what you believe. And I believe that God wants us to be blessed.
If you can do it, you can just do it.
1 Thessalonians chapter 5, 4 verses, beginning in verse number 19. It says, do not stifle the Holy Spirit. Do not scoff at prophecies, but test everything that is said. Hold on to what is good. Stay away from every kind of evil. 5 imperatives are given to us in these 4 verses. The first 2 are negative imperatives. You know, do not stifle the Holy Spirit. Do not scoff at prophecy. Those set the boundaries for the 3 positive, but test everything that is said. Hold on to what is good. Flee or run away or stay away from the things that are evil. So when it comes to matters of doctrine, when it comes to the issue of theology, then we are to judge these matters, these things, within the biblical parameters that we have. And we must exercise judgment, discernment, evaluations, so that we know what we're receiving into our life is true and an accurate reflection of what God's word has to say.
In many other false religions, there is a place for Jesus. Yeah. So if we're getting Jesus wrong, that Jesus can't save. And so I don't want to sing about that Jesus. I don't want to talk about that Jesus. And I sure don't want to point people to that Jesus. Yeah. And
so the first pushback is often, judge not lest you be judged. The second one is often, well, it's okay to expose false doctrine, but you kind of cross the line when you begin to expose false teachers. When you begin naming names. Oh, in a moment, I'm going to name some names. Some of you are going to be like, really? And some of you are following the names that I'm going to mention. I'm going to tell you about these people out of my love and my concern for your spiritual development. And they say that you should expose the doctrine, but without naming names. My first response is, man, did you even read the Bible? Listen to what Paul says in 1 Timothy chapter 1. He says, cling to your faith in Christ and keep your conscience clear. For some people have deliberately violated their consciences. As a result, their faith has been shipwrecked. General statement. Then verse 20. Hymenaeus and Alexander, they're 2 examples. He just identifies them. Just calls them out. Exposes it in front of everyone. But that's not the only place. There's other places like 2 Timothy chapter 2. Paul writes beginning in verse number 15, work hard so that you can present yourself to God and receive his approval. Be a good worker, one who does not need to be ashamed and who correctly explains the word of truth. Avoid worthless, foolish talk that only leads to more godless behavior. This kind of talk spreads like cancer. All very general, generic. Then he says, as in the case of Hymenaeus and Philetus. Just calls them out, two individuals. They've left the path of truth, claiming that the resurrection of the dead had already occurred. In this way, they have turned some people away from the faith.
You know what? Mormons are well-intentioned. Mm-hmm. You know that in Islam, there's a Jesus?
Mm-hmm. You know, I'm yay. Here's what I see. If you believe that Jesus died for your sins, then you know the gospel. That's the gospel. Don't be telling me Mormons got an extra book and Catholics do that. It's simple. Christians, we be making it too hard for people to come and be involved in this.
I hear Mitt Romney say that he believes that Jesus is the Son of God, that he's the Christ raised from the dead, that he's his Savior. That's good enough for me. And I would encourage them in the same way. Is, you know what, we don't all have the same views. And I realize Mormonism is not traditional Christianity, but I'm probably a little broader.
The reason Mormonism is not Christian is because it denies one or more of the essential doctrines of Christianity. Of these essential doctrines, for example, there's only one God. Jesus is God in flesh. Forgiveness of sins is by grace alone, by faith alone in Christ. Or Jesus rose from the dead physically, and the gospel being the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. Mormonism denies three of these. Now, how many gods there are is what it denies. It denies the true person of Christ, and it denies the true work of salvation and how we're saved. See, Mormonism teaches that God the Father has a body of flesh and bones. Now, that's in Doctrine and Covenants 130, verse 22. And that Jesus is a creation. It teaches that he was begotten in heaven as one of God's spirit children. Now, see the book Jesus the Christ by James Talmage on page 8. This is in strict contrast and contradiction to the biblical teaching that Jesus is God in flesh. That's John 1:1 and verse 14. That he is eternal. John 1:1, verse 2, and verse 15. That he is uncreated, yet born on earth, Colossians 1:15. And that he's the creator. That's John 1:3, Colossians 1, verses 16 through 17. Jesus cannot be both created and not created at the same time. Though Mormonism teaches that Jesus is God in flesh, it teaches that he is a God in flesh, one of three gods that comprises the office of the Trinity. That's Articles of Faith by James Talmage, page 35 and 40 through 40. These three gods are God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. This is in direct contradiction to the biblical teaching that there's only one God, Isaiah 44, verse 6 and 8, and 45, 5. Now, because Mormonism denies the biblical truth of who God is and who Jesus is and how forgiveness of sins is attained and what the gospel is, the Mormon is not a Christian. In spite of his claims that he is, he's not a Christian. Mormon theology teaches that God is only one of countless gods, that he used to be a man on another planet, that he became a god by following the laws and ordinances of that god on that world, and that he brought one of his wives to this world with whom he produces spirit children who then inhabit human bodies at birth. The first spirit child to be born was Jesus. The second was Satan. Well, some say he was the second, and some Mormons don't affirm that, but nevertheless. And that we all followed by being born in spirit heaven after them. But the Bible says that there's only one God, Isaiah 43:10, 44:6 and 8, 45:5, that God was eternally God, Psalm 90 verse 2, which means he was never a man on another planet. Since the Bible denies the existence of other gods and goddesses, the idea that Jesus is the product of a god and a goddess couple is completely rejected. The Bible tells us that Jesus, well, the Jesus of Mormonism, is definitely not the same Jesus that is found in the scriptures. Therefore, faith in the Mormon Jesus is faith misplaced because the Mormon Jesus doesn't exist.
I've heard people say, I can never confront another person about their sin. You know, he without sin cast the first stone. But I'm going to say that to dodge this difficult and loving responsibility is the very opposite of love. And if you see a child running out into a street about to get hit by a car, I would think love would motivate you to yell, to do whatever is necessary to try to rescue that child, to protect that child from danger. So likewise, we see a fellow believer that is following the path, a dangerous path of dangerous teaching and heretical views, then love ought to motivate us to shout, to do whatever we can to get their attention, to stay away from that danger.
What we're doing is we're judging doctrine. We're judging what it is that they're teaching. And there's a reality that a lot of this music is good music.
Yeah.
It's produced really well. Mm. It sounds great.
Sounds
it's
great.
Got a hook. I mean, yep. it's stuff that makes people feel good.
Yep. And some of it is even doctrinally fairly sound. Just keep it in isolation.
And we talked about one song before where one of your favorite songs, just to put you on blast.
Right.
And
sure.
I'm with you. The yeah. No Longer Slaves.
Love,
right?
When that song first came out, before I kind of got into this issue, mm-hmm. I loved that song.
Yep.
Absolutely.
So it's not like the movement has just blatant heresy and they're just spewing false doctrine in every song, and now you couldn't sing any of it or you're going to hell. It's not what we're saying. You would say this is convictional, and also the old cliche, even a broken clock is right twice
That's
a day.
Right.
Let's just rip off the band-aid. First and foremost, I warned you, be very, very careful. I would stay away from the teachings, from the writings, from the spiritual wisdom that is shared from Pope Francis. Now, some of you are like, well, wait, here we go. Stay away from it. It's not biblical. I can give you a list of reasons that cause me concern. I'll share with you one. Pope Francis himself said, we are living in a time when religious believers and people of goodwill everywhere sense the need to grow a mutual understanding and respect and support each other as members of one human family. That sounds all good. I don't have any problem with that. Then he says, for all of us are children of God. And to make sure I'm not like just misunderstanding what he's saying or what he's trying to express, he also says many think differently, feel differently, seeking God or meeting God in different ways. In this crowd, in this range of religions, there is only one certainty that we have for all. We are all children of God. Let me tell you what, when the Pope says that we are all children of God, he does not reveal the truth of Scriptural. He only reveals his ignorance of the Word of God. This is what Scripture says. For those of you that are already resisting and already pushing back, this is what the Word of God says. John chapter 1, verse number 10. He came into the very world he created, but the world didn't recognize him. He came to his own people, and even they rejected him. But to all who believed him and accepted him, he gave the right to become children of God. So who are the children of God? Those that believe and accept him. It says they are reborn, not with a physical birth, but a birth that comes from God. Then it says in 1 John chapter 3, verses 9 and 10, those who have been born into God's family do not make a practice of sinning, because God's life is in them. So they can't keep on sinning because they are children of God. Who are the children of God? Those that are born into God's family. How are you born into God's family? By believing and accepting Jesus Christ into your life.
There are millions of ways to be a
then
human
how do
being.
You please God?
And many ways, no, but many paths to what you call God.
That
and her
crazy.
Path might be something else, and when she gets there, she might call it the light. But her loving and her kindness and her generosity brings her, if it brings her to the same point that it brings you, it doesn't matter whether she called it God along the way or not.
Yeah, but if you really look at both sides, I
there couldn't
person.
Possibly be just one way. What about Jesus? What about Jesus?
Only one way. There is one way and only one way, and
there
that is through Jesus.
There couldn't possibly be
because
with
you
of people
say
in
there
the
isn't.
There are two classes of humanity, the child of God and the child of the devil. If you don't have your faith, your belief rooted in the Son of God, then you belong to the devil. You're his kid, not God's.
The music is a huge part
oh,
of it.
Sure
Without
it
the music, none of this stuff
there's,
would work.
There's nothing.
It doesn't work.
That's right.
Stay away from that teaching. It sounds religious, but it is not biblical. I warn you. Here we go. Stay away from the teachings, the declarations, the preaching, the books from people like Joel Osteen. Stay away from Bishop T.D. Jakes. It's heresy that comes out of his mouth. Stay away from Joyce Meyer, Kenneth and Gloria Copeland, Benny Hinn, Brian Houston of Hillsong, Bill Johnson of Bethel. I'll come back to those guys in a moment. Stay away from Jen Hatmaker. She's a false teacher. She doesn't believe in the biblical view of marriage, the biblical view of sexuality. Don't follow her. Joseph Prince, stay away from him. Fred Price, Creflo Dollar. Oh, I'm going to be nice. Todd White is another one. Rob Bell and Oprah Winfrey, whatever tour that they're on together. She literally says that there's millions of different paths to get to God. And what you call Jesus is good for you, but all that matters is that you're faithful and true on whatever path that you're on. We all end up in the same place. It's just garbage. We as a church will no longer sing songs from Bethel Collective, from Hillsong, Hillsong United. We're not singing songs from Jesus Culture. We're not singing songs from Jeremy Riddle, from Corey Asbury, and a list of 15 or 16 other different artists. So why are we taking this position? Why are we no longer singing their music? Why are we no longer going to be doing that? Because they align themselves with, or they come from, churches that are theologically problematic, if not outright heretical. It's like, you got to be careful. You can't just pull the good that's in those songs and say, it's okay for us just to sing the good stuff and avoid the other stuff. It's not how it works. You do realize, or maybe you don't, when you purchase an album from them or when their church sings a song of theirs, that we are financially supporting their ministries. So when this church, in order to be able to play music that is copyrighted, we have to purchase on an annual basis something that's called the CCLI. It's a license. It gives you permission to sing copyrighted music. And then you turn in songs, a list of songs, and how many times you sing them. You have to report this kind of stuff. And so what happens is each church that pays the license fee, and then when they collect all the data and information, then those artists or those groups receive compensation based upon the number of times their song gets sung in a number of churches. So when we sing one of their songs, we become financially contributors of their churches that they come from.
That's right. That's right. Or, you know, the devil ain't coming to deceive people with all lies. Doesn't he use some truth?
So as you guys already talked, this comes down to Christology. Mm-hmm. This comes down to what Jesus are you singing about, mm-hmm. right? And when you use like terms, like LDS, they use the name of Christ, and it seems like they're talking about the same Jesus mm-hmm. much of the time until you lift the hood up yeah. on their theology and mm-hmm. what they truly believe. And this is a very similar situation with NAR. You have to lift the hood up. What do they believe? And when you listen to them in their own words, we're not putting words in anybody's mouth.
Nope. Mm-hmm.
In their own words, they are teaching and believing in a different Jesus other than the Bible. Mm-hmm. That's not in the Bible, I should say.
Yeah.
So when they're producing music that seemingly is using the same terms that an Orthodox yeah. church like ours would use, mm-hmm. There's a comfort level to it. There's a hook to it, like, oh, yeah. they're singing about my Lord,
yeah.
until you find out that they're not.
Really, let's good. Strip the service of music, dim lights, glory glitter.
Right.
You just stand at a pulpit, and as best you can, exegete that word. And let's see if people get lit on fire and fall down.
Right.
Not going to happen.
Not going to happen. Not
it is a happen. Show.
It's an absolute show. Now, not everyone who gets slain in the spirit, not everyone who exhibit some of these things. They're not necessarily, some of them are outright manufacturing it. Some
sure.
of them, it's complete manufacture. Some of them, they think they're experiencing something,
yeah.
but it's psychosomatic, it's mind over body. You can take video clips of people in Hindu Kundalini.
and put them side by side video clips yeah. of Bethel or what's going on at IHOP or, you know, this stuff.
Yeah.
And they, you can't tell the difference.
Right.
They look exactly alike. They speak in tongues. People in Hindu Kundalini speak in tongues in the exact same way that people in charismatic churches do.
Told you I'd come back to him, and so let's just camp out here for a moment. I'll start with Brian Houston of Hillsong, Hillsong United. Hillsong Church is a Pentecostal megachurch that's affiliated within the Australian Christian Churches. It is the Australian branch of the Assemblies of God. And part of their doctrinal belief is that of the prosperity gospel. This quote comes directly from Hillsong's website. It says, "We believe that God wants to heal and transform us so that we can live healthy and blessed lives in order to help others more effectively. And this falls in line with the teaching that God always wills to heal and that blessed equals healthy." That's the prosperity gospel, which adds that God's desire is to enrich you financially. And just to make sure you don't think I'm stretching or you know, grabbing at straws just from one line from their website, let me read to you a direct quote from their pastor. He published a book. His book was published many years ago, but the name of the book ought to get our attention. You Need More Money. It's his book. In his book, You Need More Money, on page number 8, Brian Houston says, we have to become comfortable with wealth and break the bondage, guilt, and condemnation of impoverished thinking. Poverty is definitely not God's will for his people. In fact, his promises talk of blessing and prosperity. Say that the prosperity gospel is either a perversion of the true gospel or it falls so far off course it is another gospel completely. Either way, it has no place in the church and ought to have no place in the life of a true Christian in their biblical worldview. Let me read to you what Paul says, and he gives a warning to Timothy. In fact, I want you to see it for yourself. Turn with me to 1 Timothy chapter 6. I know some of you are done listening to me. You've checked out. I get it. Just thank you for not walking out. That would be a distraction. Draw a picture in your bulletin. 1 Timothy chapter 6. Listen to what Paul says. Beginning in verse number 2, the very end of verse number 2. "Teach these things, Timothy, and encourage everyone to obey. Some people may contradict our teaching, but these are the wholesome teachings of the Lord Jesus Christ. These teachings promote a godly life. Anyone who teaches something different is arrogant and lacks understanding. Such a person has an unhealthy desire to quibble over the meaning of words. This stirs up arguments, ending in jealousy, division, slander, and evil suspicions. These people always cause trouble. Their minds are corrupt, and they have turned their backs on the truth. To them, a show of godliness is just a way to become wealthy. Verse 6, yet true godliness is with contentment is itself great wealth. After all, we brought nothing with us when we came into the world, and we can't take anything with us when we leave it. So if we have enough food and clothing, let us be content. But people who long to be rich fall into temptation and are trapped by many foolish and harmful desires that plunge them into ruin and destruction." And then it says in verse 10, "For the love of money," not money in and of itself, it's the love of money, "is the root of all kinds of evil. And some people craving money have wandered from true faith and pierced themselves with many sorrow." Paul also says in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, "I hope that you'll put up a little more with my foolishness. Please bear with me. For I am jealous for you with the jealousy of God himself. I promised you a pure bride to one husband, Christ." Then he says in verse number 3, "But I fear that somehow your pure and undivided devotion to Christ will be corrupted. Just as Eve was deceived by the cunning ways of the serpent. Verse 4, you happily put up with whatever anyone tells you, even if they preach a different Jesus than the one we preach. Even if they preach a different kind of spirit than the one that you've received. And even if they preach a different kind of gospel than the one you believed.
One of the things, too, we would say is, we're not commanding this of other churches or other people. These are our convictions. And our convictions do not have to be your commands. However, we should all fairly understand and clearly understand why people have the positions that they do. And so we want to continue to make clear that we are not going to sing active heretics and point people to active heresy where they're going to think, you know, you're muddying the water here. You've got to pay royalties to these people as well with CCLI and some of the legal proceedings now. And so we don't want to pay money to heresy.
That's right.
We don't want to partner with it in any way, shape, or form. That's our conviction.
At the NAR conference or event, they don't do teaching conferences. They're all concerts.
Right.
They will have glory glitter and say, look at the whole presence of the Holy Spirit. Or I feel like I'm on fire and I twitch and I shirk and I jerk. Versus the individual who believes the third person of the Trinity convicts a dead sinner of sin, righteousness, judgment, raises them to new life, and then takes the filthiest of people, cleanses them, and begins to sanctify them.
Yes.
Now that's a powerful work.
That is the, Todd, that right there, that is the work of the Holy Spirit. Not gold glitter and angel feathers.
That's
and people
a low
barking.
View of the Holy
exactly.
Spirit.
Exactly, and this is what I wish people could understand. This is exactly the point. It is one of the heights of theological ironies that the very people who claim to have such an emphasis on the Holy Spirit,
right,
such they focus on Him and His work, and they would look at people like you and me, oh, you don't believe in the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
You don't believe in His power. To the contrary, I am so confident in the power in the person and the working of the Holy Spirit of God that I do not believe that someone can be indwelt by Him and teach the kinds of heresies that these people teach and have no prick of their conscience whatsoever. That's the Holy Spirit is too strong for that. If He is strong enough to save us, He is strong enough to deliver us out of deception.
Mm-hmm.
And salvation is a package deal in the sense, 1 Corinthians 6:11, Paul gives this long list of sins. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor effeminate, nor homosexuals, covetous, drunkards, revilers, swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. And he says, but such were some of you. And then he says, but you were washed, you were sanctified, justified. Those three terms, the two bookend terms, washed, justified, and right in the middle, sanctified. Those whom God saves, He sanctifies.
That's right.
There's no exceptions.
Right.
No exceptions. So it is the true height of theological ironies that the people who claim to have the highest view of Him, of the Holy Spirit, have the lowest view.
Brian Houston, in the whole prosperity gospel pursuit and doctrine is corrupt, it's unbiblical, and you should stay away from it. We get to the matter of Bethel. This is a little bit more weird at times. I didn't know much about their ministry and what they do and how they're organized and the school that they have in order to train other prophets and healers and whatnot. But Bethel, the leadership, practices, promotes, endorses, I don't really know which one is the right word, but something that's been referred to as grave sucking. Other words are grave soaking or mantle passing. Some of you never even heard of this before, nor did I. This is what it is. It's the practice is based upon the idea that the spiritual calling of an individual who has died may be reclaimed by somebody else. The theory is that God uses the Holy Spirit to anoint certain believers with a specific purpose, such as healing or prophecy. But when that person dies, the work of God has been thwarted. thus the Holy Spirit is wasted. It's lying upon the bones and unable to continue the calling. And so this unrecovered, that's how they phrase it, the unrecovered anointing is apparently available to anyone who would physically come and claim it for themselves. Some people have said, oh, it's just an inside joke. It's not really serious. It's something that's just taking out of context. I've seen that argument. I've heard that argument. But this isn't taking it out of context. Take a look at this picture. There we go. That's the pastor's wife, Benny Johnson. She's in Oxford. She's currently lying at the tomb in that picture of C.S. Lewis, soaking it up, trying to get the residual anointing that's contained within that grave. You can't really see it from there. I get it. But the little comments on the side become evident that this is a practice, a teaching that exists among them. When they say, grab some for me. Grab some for me too. Wow. Then the next one. So it's not an isolated incident. There's the picture of her hugging onto the tombstone of Charles Finney, trying to soak in his anointing. If you need further evidence, I don't know why you would, but just in case if you do, Bill Johnson himself wrote the book called The Physics of Heaven. And in chapter 4, he says this: there are anointings, mantles, revelations, and mysteries that have laid unclaimed, literally, where they were left, because the generation that walked in them never passed them on. I believe it's possible for us to recover realms of anointing, realms of insight. Then he says, realms of God that have been untended for decades simply by choosing to reclaim them and perpetuate them for future generations. I mean, that's superstitious practice is blaintly, it's superstition, it's unbiblical, it's crazy. There's nowhere in Scripture that teaches this. Stay away from it. And they also promote something that's called the kenosis theory. Oh, this is problematic too. This is a whole nother gospel. This is the warning that we read in 1 John chapter 4, verse number 3. If they don't teach the truth about Jesus, then it's not from God. It's from the spirit of the Antichrist. The kenosis theory goes like this, that Jesus, when he left heaven to come to earth, abandoned his deity in heaven. So that when he was on earth 100% man, and that's it. And they base that on Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 8. Let me read that for you real quick. It says, have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped. And verse 7 says, but he emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. They pick up on the phrase, emptied himself. And that's what they say. They say that he left his divine attributes in heaven when he emptied himself. But that's not what this verse is talking about. This verse doesn't talk anything about his divine attributes. This verse is talking about the humility of our Lord when he abandoned the praise and worship of heaven to enter into our mess and our muck here on earth. It's talking about his humility. And the kenosis theory is dangerous because if you believe that Jesus was only a man, then the logic goes Jesus was able to perform the miracles and raise the dead because he was a man walking in right relationship with God. And if you being a man are also walking in a right relationship with God, then you can do those miracles too, and we can train you how to do them.
So for churches who would say, you know what, we'll just sing this one Bethel song or these two Hillsong tunes that are really good, and they sing the truth, and they do give truth to our people. that would be tantamount to us saying, if Bill Johnson would come and preach a biblical exegetical sermon in our church, then we'll let him come fill the pulpit just for that one time.
That's a great
practically
point.
Pragmatically, that's the exact same thing. We would never do that. And that's as a community, we would be ripped to shreds for doing that. And everybody would say, why in the world would you do that? Well, the exact same thing is happening with music every Sunday in many churches around the country when heresy is creeping in one step at a time through the music. Because pragmatically, like we've talked about before, it's beautiful, it gets people in the door, and it's popular.
I mean, this is such an important issue. Jesus talked about it in his first sermon, right? Mm-hmm. So Matthew chapter 7, Jesus says very plainly, beware.
Yes. Yeah.
Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing. Mm. So they might look like you, but beware, because they're bringing a different message. Yes. And that message is not my message.
Yeah.
So if our Lord said beware, all we're doing is saying, listen to what Jesus is saying. Yeah, beware. Right. Do your homework.
Yeah.
Learn about this. Don't just take our word for it.
That's right.
Do your own work on it and figure this out.
Amen. And I mean, I'm not being snarky or sarcastic when I say this. Growing up in the circle that I did, and now being as old as I am and just having experience with some of this, I always want to ask people, you know, why are you so excited and so deeply convicted to sing Bethel and to sing Jesus Culture and to reach this generation? But 20 years ago and for the last 20 years, you refused to buy my uncle's instrumental CD. You're not playing the Benny Hinn worship CD in your churches. I've had like conservative guys that are even more right, you know, over the right side of things, and I mean really deeply convicted guys over things, have told me before, I've heard your Uncle Benny preach better gospel presentations than Baptist preachers. Mm-hmm. So it's really not about the fact that these people don't offer anything or that there's nothing truthful in it.
Yeah.
The real question is, you know, what are we going for? Are we caving to the culture? Am I letting the radio DJ and the top, you know, Billboard hits dictate what I sing? Mm-hmm. Am I letting my methodological leanings dictate now my theological convictions? Then sing them all. Welcome them all in. Open the doors for everyone and live with the conviction all the way. Take it to its logical conclusion. Mm-hmm. And so I don't say that to be snarky or sarcastic. It's just always been interesting to me that the minute it got cool, the minute it had V-necks and skinny jeans and leather jackets and it made it into the mainstream, was the minute a whole bunch of churches decided, you know what, this is what people like. Kyle, you mentioned pragmatism. Mm-hmm. You know what, let's do it. This will grow it, this will build it, and all those other guys are just stuck up, you know, theology nerds.
We're exporters. I don't ever want to change that. But my heart burns to be able to say, you know what, let's experiment at home. Let's get it working. Let's get the wrinkles ironed out of this thing, and let's get a model that can be duplicated anywhere in the world. And let's get that model. And it's not American culture, it's revival culture. And let's take it somewhere. And let's plant it. Let's plant it through Jesus Culture. Let's plant it through the music we write. Let's plant it through the conferences that we do, the conferences that we bring in people for.
God needs you saved. He needs you full of the Holy Ghost. He needs you well, and he needs you strong, and he needs you rich.
And we say your time for abundance has arrived. Your time for abundance has arrived. The overflow has arrived for you. He is a good, good God. He is a good, good God. He is springing forth life right now into bank accounts. He is springing forth life. I feel like there's some of you in this room right now, and you have things that you've been waiting to sell. And I want to tell you, this is the season for you to get more than you ever thought you would. I pray right now that such a favor, I want for you all to say something over these people. The favor of the Lord surrounds you like a shield.
I warned you, be very, very careful.
You reproduce what you behold.
I refuse to create a theology that allows for sickness.
Does God ever choose not to heal? No.
I was here in church one time. I said, God, will you show me the angels that are in here? And all of a sudden I saw this huge angel standing through the roof. And I said, can you? I started looking at his weapon. I started looking at his clothes. I started looking at his face. I asked him his name, and he tells me his name, and I typed it in on Google. I hope you're okay with me telling you this. I just got to tell you this, because if I don't tell you this, you you just need to hear testimonies so you can know what's available to you, because I'm not trying to preach a sermon. I'm trying to give you, invite you to a new way of life. So I see this giant angel, and I asked him his name. I won't tell you his name. He tells me his name. I Google it. It's a financial company, and I realized this angel is here for the finances for our finances here at Bethel, and the finances, period.
Well, I'd like for us to read together offering number, I believe it's 4 tonight. Let's say this together tonight. As we pray for new wells of revival, we pray for new economic wells in Reading to be created. So, Lord, we ask you for favor for our city with CEOs, government leaders, and kings, firms that produce goods for the nations and provide new jobs for our people, technology to establish new markets, energy sources, and efficient solutions to grow as a population, laws and courts that measure with the justice and the freedom of our land's constitution, civil servants that encourage entrepreneurs, and a media known for wisdom and truth, released, harvested, sold, and reproduced, education, books, and universities that develop mind molders who influence the influential. Capital to build small businesses that provide services, arts, and culture, attracting both young and old. Medical community known for integrity and excellence. Repentance from poverty, small thinking, and envy. Courage to recognize opportunities and make wealth.
Money! Come up to me!
Abundance to bless the world and the prudence to save and invest. Revelation to pass on wealth to our children's children. So we declare that when the righteous prosper, the city rejoices. Hallelujah!
So good. We had some of the finest teaching we've ever had here released this week. And Lance Wallnau was his usual amazing, outrageous self.
Because most believers on the earth are more frightened at the prospect of taking on the insurmountable giants represented by the mountains near them in their nations. They're more intimidated by trying to take possession of what is a opposition that has strength and fortification in the natural. From the IRS to Hollywood to whatever. Most believers are afraid. So they create a theology that eliminates the responsibility for having to take territory and rather focuses on just getting people saved so that when Jesus comes back, he can repopulate the earth with people that are followers and let him take over the planet.
Now, first of all, I want to point out these two words, dominion and mandate. The word mandate, you've got to understand, mandate means an authoritative order or command. It doesn't mean a good idea. It doesn't mean a suggestion. It means an authoritative order. Dominion has to do with control. Dominion has to do with rulership. Dominion has to do with authority and subduing. And it relates to society. One of the last things that Eleanor danced to were the words, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." In other words, what it's talking about, what the values are in heaven need to be made manifest here on earth. Dominion means being the head and not the tail. Dominion means ruling as kings.
I tell you what, the Lord's been speaking to me about heavy rain. Heavy rain.
We're longing for a downpour.
interceded. Oh, that all God's people were prophets.
So we've got to applaud. You know, Chris does an amazing job. He'll take like a room like this. He'll pair you off, and he'll say, all right, everybody on the right, give a word of knowledge. In other words, something you couldn't know in the natural about the person you're faced off with. At the end, we'll ask the question, you know, how many of you got it right? They raise their hand. Everybody claps. He says, how many of you got it wrong? They raise their hands. Everybody claps. You know, we're not talking about moral failure. We're talking about, as leaders, we have to create an environment where risk is applauded, knowing that eventually there will be breakthrough.
I want to pray for this prophetic anointing. You guys would laugh if you knew how. I'm just going to tell you. You know how we started the prophetic in Weaverville years ago? There was zero prophetic. Zero. There wasn't a prophetic mouse. There wasn't a prophetic flea. There was zero. So I'd get men, sit around a table. And I'd turn to the one on my right, I'd say, if Jesus were to walk in the room right now, what do you think he'd say? And he'd go, oh, I think he'd say. And I'd go to the next one, he'd go all the way around the room. And after we got all the way around the room, I'd say, do you realize that you all just prophesied? And they're like, oh, is that easy? See, when you strive is when you miss it. Yeah. It's when you relax in who you are, abiding in presence, abiding in his voice, it becomes very natural to speak words that are life-giving.
People, I tell you the truth, people abandoned Todd. He was going through a real difficult thing a year and a half ago. Many abandoned him. They're back on his wagon now. And he's graciously welcomed them all back.
And I'm thinking, God, why is not the power of God moving? He said, because you haven't kicked that woman in the face.
So I'm in my hotel, and I'm in my bathroom, and it's the middle of the night, and I open my hotel room, and I turn the light on, and there's a man in there, in my bathroom. And I looked at this man, he didn't have a shirt on, so I thought he must have got into the wrong hotel room. First thought. You're in the wrong room, bro. Like, you're in my bathroom. I turn the light on. You're in the bath, no shirt on. And then I realized he was wearing funny, like, white yoga pants. Like, really tight, white, ballet-type pants. And, like, Aladdin golden slippers. And I looked down at him, and I thought, whoa, this isn't a man. This is an angel. But it appeared to me as a person, a man. So I'm not having a dream. It's not a trance. I'm wide awake. I'm in my bathroom. And I'd never had an angelic encounter where it was like in this world, like a messenger from heaven.
We felt as a staff and a leadership that I needed to kind of alert you to something. So I met this week with our students, our student body, and I had four meetings this week to talk about the same thing. And that's to give a warning about an individual whose life and ministry has become horribly deceived and contaminated. And so I'm throwing up alert signs. One of the sons of our house, which makes it so sad, is someone that we have held in high esteem, and I've had such wonderful times with in my personal life as well as in ministry, is Jason Westerfield.
With that spirit, and that sound that's in the light, the tempo of the rhythms, of the cadences, the vibrations, the frequencies, the songs, the dance, the motion, the movement, the light.
One of the beautiful things that happened is when I finished with the solar system, it completely reorientated me to not just where we're currently at and where we're going to, but it cleared out the timeline and the histories of the emotional frequency and the holograms of our racial memory. It came off. When all of that came off, I felt completely whole. I was expanded, and I was trying to figure this thing out. Then he said, are you ready? I said, okay. So we looked at each other eye to eye till it connected in here in the core and locked on. He goes, here we go. Next thing you know, I went up to the galactic center. As I went through that time tunnel, I went through that passageway, it's really like kind of a wormhole that goes through.
So good. We had some of the finest teaching we've ever had here released this week. And Larry Randolph stayed over, and
Bob Jones is my best friends of my life, Laura and I, 20-something years. I miss him so much because that guy was weird. But he thought he was normal and everybody else was weird.
Bob and Bonnie right down here in the front row. Honor them, would you please? Thank you guys so much. Thank you, thank you. Thank you, thank you. Thank you. Well, we just owe so much. We owe so much to the fathers that have really prophesied this day into being.